I met Mitropoulos when I was a teenager, and he was the conductor of the orchestra in Minnesota, Minneapolis, Minnesota at the time, but he was guest conducting the Philadelphia Orchestra. And one of his best friends was a childhood friend of my mother's, and she said, well, Mr. Mitropoulos is going to be in Philadelphia, and he'd like to come to this little place where my folks used to go out in New Jersey, out by the ocean. And he said, just to get away from everything where there wouldn't be any pressure, any society or business stuff, just to be with some family people and just be anonymous. My mother said, well, sure, because she loved music and she knew I was trying to be a musician. So he came and visited. I was downstairs practicing the French horn. My mother said, he said, God bless that boy. He's practicing his French horn on Sunday. Then I came upstairs and he spoke to me. And the whole time I was there, here I was, a 12-year-old kid. He was just encouraging me and inspiring me. And he was that way to young people and to older musicians down on their luck. One time there was a famous flute player in an orchestra who played great, but he had a big family. And he said to Mitropoulos, he said, you know, Maestro, I wish I could sound better for you. I love playing for you. He said, but I just have such an old flute and it's all shot and everything leaks and it never can be repaired to sound the way it should. He said, well, you must get a new one. He said, well, Maestro, I've got 6 children. He said, well, how much would a new one cost? He said, oh, Maestro, it would take me years to pay for it. He said, how much will it cost? So he told him, he said, here, and he wrote him out a check. And he gave away all of his money. He lived in the Great Northern Hotel when he became conductor of the New York Philharmonic in one room and just sat there studying scores all day and encouraging and helping out people. Now, I wouldn't expect everybody in the world to be like that, and I certainly couldn't be like that to that extent. I don't know anybody. But he showed us that you didn't have to be selfish and greedy and narcissistic and nasty and abusive, and there was another way of thinking about your role in music and in life. He was a huge inspiration. And in music, he said, you know, that the loving the music was the most important thing, that music was a mountain, and that every kind of sincere music was a stone in that mountain. And he used to say, how is your friend Dizzy Gillespie? I liked his last recording, his harmonic inventions. He would go into all that stuff. He was really listening to that music way back then and appreciating it. Pretty remarkable, you know, that he was able to do that. And he loved all different kinds of music and was so gracious to people. And he was a huge influence on everybody that ever met him. And he encouraged me when I was just a kid to be a composer, to dare to go for it. And he said, you know, whatever you have to do to get by, don't give up your music. Just try to be better, work hard, and be serious. And also to be polite and respectful to people. And he also said, if you ever get to conduct, he said, you have to dress up, stand up straight, clean. He didn't say clean up your act, but that's essentially what he meant. He said, because otherwise it's just like you're disgracing the music and other people. He said, it's a real responsibility to be an artist. You're like an ambassador for the arts and a higher power. He'd actually studied to be a monk originally, and he was very religious, but in the beautiful sense, because he was spiritual. He didn't tell you that you had to adopt his religion. I'm not even sure what his religion was. He said his religion was music, but he was a really spiritual and selfless person, almost like a role model for people who reached St. Francis, just completely selfless. And Jack Kerouac was that way to a large extent, which also gave him a lot of problems because people said, well, what's the guy being so nice for? It was almost that once you get a certain... Here was Dmitri Mitropoulos, the conductor of the New York Philharmonic, and he was so kind to everybody, to all the musicians, to all the people, to anybody whose path crossed. One time I was in an elevator with him and my mother, and he was in Philadelphia visiting his friend, Henry Gersley, who was the guy that had brought him to our place, and we went to see him. And the elevator operator, that was the days they used to have on that little outfit, you know, the suit, And he said in his Philadelphia accent, "Maestro, I don't mean to attack you in the elevator, but I want to show you a song I wrote and have you tell me what you think." So Mitropoulos said, "Well, let me see it." So he pulled out a lead sheet of some kind of a song that he'd written, like a, you know, popular song with some words, a melody, and some chord changes. So Mitropoulos said, "Stop the elevator when you get to my floor." So he stood there in the elevator so the guy wouldn't get fired, and he pushed the button that you push when there's, you have to move a chair or something. And he stood there for about 10 minutes looking at it, saying, "Well," he said, "I like the setting of your words here. Your lyrics are very interesting. And the way your melody and this harmonies," he went through the whole thing, giving a PhD crash course in the song that this guy had written, as if he were analyzing, you know, a Beethoven or Brahms or Haydn symphony or a novel by Dostoevsky. He really got into the nitty-gritty, and it was so beautiful. And the reason was because he believed that was what he should do in life. Someone asked him for something, and it was something that he could give, and he was happy to do it. And he was an extraordinary person. And when you meet one person in your life like that, it's really great.